Great. Good morning. Thanks, Pastor Dave. So good to have you here and hosting our service for us this morning. Man, great to be with you this morning. Before we get going in the message, I want to mention one other thing. We have finally got to the point where there is construction happening here at the campus. Okay? So you'll see a lot more happening, but if you head out sort of, you know, where the kids' check-in is, go downstairs, they've retiled that area. If you walk through the Montessori side, in the downstairs area, there's some carpet that's all been ripped out. They're doing some stuff there. All that's prepped for this coming week for a big shift to take place or begin to take place with some of the things with our kids' stuff, where that's going to be located, and the work will continue downstairs. That long-awaited restroom is going to be gutted, I think. So anyway, so exciting times, lots of moving parts, lots of exciting things happening here at the campus. So yeah, feel free to walk around and check that out. Anyway, it's great to be with you. I haven't preached here for 3 weeks. I haven't really been doing anything. No, I'm just kidding. I have been busy, but it was good to have somebody else step in for a couple weeks. I was at Rolling Meadows, of course, for that 1 week as well. But good to be back here. And so if you open your Bibles this morning, we're going to be in Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13, still in the same series that we've been in on the parables of Jesus. Okay, so when I was in Bible college, like 2 years ago, a lot longer than that, yes. When I was in Bible college a number of years ago, I was a brand new Christian. I was a Christian for maybe about a year, and man, I was on like fire in terms of boldness and passion for the Lord. And I remember what we would do is, I mean, we're in the middle of absolutely nothing, okay? We're in the prairies in Saskatchewan, Canada, at a Bible college that's there. And it's freezing cold in the winter. I kind of like here, but I think probably worse. And what we would do as guys in our dorm, because this was the exciting thing to do on a Friday night, you would get in your car if you could get it started, right? Because you had to have a block heater. And you'd start that thing up, and a few of the cars would head out, and we would go to Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, Canada, 15 minutes away. And we would go to the place that you would go. I mean, where else are you going to go except for to 7-Eleven at the time, right? So we'd go to 7-Eleven, and we would all buy our Slurpees and all of our junk food or whatever we wanted to, and then we'd make our way back to the campus. Well, this one Friday night, we showed up at 7-Eleven, and there was like a mob of high school students outside the 7-Eleven, probably about 50 of them or so gathered. There was probably about 5 or 6 of us from the Bible college that had made it there. And we went inside the store, we bought our stuff and came outside. And with that just sort of youthful passion and zeal and wanting to tell people about a relationship with Jesus Christ, we entered into this conversation or multiple conversations with all the high school students. And it was so interesting in terms of their response to things. You know, as we kind of all broke into different groups, kind of not on purpose, but it just kind of naturally happened, little clusters of groups were around each of the guys from the Bible college. And I can remember looking around at one point because the varied responses of the people that were there. There were some, I kid you not, who got down on their knees mocking every word that was said. That probably doesn't surprise you. Some who were lifting up their hands in mockery, pretending to call upon God. Some who were arguing, of course, entering into debate, trying to sort of find their arguments that they thought were compelling against the Christian methods. Some were listening in silence. They were just hearing, listening. And some legitimately had questions. They really wanted to know. And it was really interesting. Now, to my knowledge, nobody on that day gave their life to Jesus Christ. Even though all of them heard what was being said that day. You see, it's possible to hear, but not really hear. It's possible to hear words, but not have what we would say is the spiritual capacity to truly hear. It's possible to understand things intellectually even, to grasp the words that are being spoken, but not truly understand. It's possible to see with your eyes and yet not truly see. During my first semester of Bible college, I had a really radically different encounter. I was my first semester, and we were on the way back in October. It was in Canada, Thanksgiving in October. We got in the car. We were going across the Rocky Mountains, treacherous time to go across the Rocky Mountains. There was a group of us, and I was like the freshman, and everybody else were like seniors, so we're heading back home. And we pulled into this gas station, and I remember this taxi driver comes flying into the gas station. And he skids and does like a big, not a full donut, but and he came close to our car. And again, not thinking, I said, "Let me out of the car." So Greg, who was driving the car, he's like, what are you doing? I'm just let me out of the car. I got out of the car and I walked up to the taxi. I opened up the passenger side of the taxi. I sat in the taxi and I looked at the guy and I said, "What are you doing? What are you doing? You came flying in here. You could have killed anybody." And he just melted on the spot. He just looked at me and said, "I've had the absolutely worst day you could possibly imagine." It seemed like his whole life was unraveling. He was going through all kinds of... I'm like 17 or 18 at the time, right? And he opened up to me, and I ended up sharing with him the truth about who Jesus is. And he drove his car through the car wash at this time in Calgary, Alberta, Canada. We came out the other side, sat in that car for probably, I think it might have been an hour. Meanwhile, all the guys that I was driving with were in the other car. And they were praying because they were like, "What in the world is going on?" When they saw the car leave and go through the car wash, they were like, "What in the world's Cory doing?" But I remember because I had an opportunity. I led that man to Jesus that day. Now, I don't know where he is today, but he had ears to hear. He had ears to hear. He had eyes and he could see. He understood in a way that only one could understand if God gives him the spiritual capacity to understand. You see, all of that to say that just as that's true today, so that same kind of response was also there in the life of Jesus. People responded to Jesus in very similar ways. You know, when Jesus came into this world and he began his ministry in Mark chapter 1, verse 14 and 15, we read that he came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." And we know when you read the gospel of Mark, everywhere he went, or read the gospel of Matthew, any of the gospels, everywhere he went, he preached the gospel and people heard with their ears. But not everyone has or had the ears to truly hear what he was saying. Consider this, for example, the ministry of Jesus while he was here. Great crowds were always around him. People were drawn to Jesus, and for all kinds of reasons. In those crowds, there were some who were genuinely his followers, or we call them disciples, and some were not. They appeared to be so. Some heard his message and accepted it, and others heard the message, and yet they only appeared on the surface to accept it and be his disciples. Of those who heard his message and only appeared to be his disciples, the Gospel of John tells us that they ended up ditching Jesus when they heard some of Jesus' more difficult teachings of what it really meant to follow him. In particular, when he taught them that to have eternal life, they must eat his flesh and drink his blood, not understanding really what he was saying. Of these pseudo-followers, John 6:66, just kind of happens to be John 6:66, tells us that at that time, many of the disciples turned back and they no longer walked with him. You see, they started out strong, but then they turned away because they were unwilling to count the cost of being genuine followers of Jesus Christ. And it wasn't just the people in the crowd that had varied response. Consider even as you get to Matthew chapter 12 or Mark chapter 3, right before the text that we'll be going into this morning, we're told that Jesus' own family rejected him. They thought that he was mad. Not mad like angry, but mad meaning out of his mind, crazy. They actually sought to apprehend him because of he was going around and talking to people about the kingdom. And then who can forget, of course, also in Matthew chapter 12, just before our passage, that the religious leaders, one of many accounts where the religious leaders say, you know how he's doing what he's doing? It's because he's possessed by Beelzebul, that is the Lord of the flies, the prince of all the demons. That's how he's casting out these demons. You see, at every turn, Jesus seemed to be rejected and rejected and rejected. There was always those who accepted him, but there were always those who also rejected him. And it's with that background in mind that we turn to this text in Matthew 13, the beginning of the parables of Jesus. And it's in this text that Jesus gives us a parable which explains this: why some reject the gospel and others do not. You see, I believe that Jesus taught this parable really as a response to all that had happened before. If we were in the Gospel of Mark, we would look in chapter 1, 2, and 3 and how it was just rejection, 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 rejection. And then he gets into the boat right in this town of Capernaum and he teaches them and he tells them this parable, explaining to them really why his message isn't being received. It's the same here in Matthew chapter 12 when you read about the rejection, of Jesus. He again gets in the boat and he tells the same parable, the parable of the soils, as we refer to it, or the parable of the sower. Now, why did Jesus teach these parables? Well, I want you to note, first of all, before we answer that question, that in chapter 13, verses 1 through 3, here's the context. It says, that same day, Jesus went out of the house. Now, he's in the town of Capernaum, and maybe you've been to Capernaum in Israel. I've been to Capernaum right on the Sea of Galilee, and it's actually just, it's mesmerizing when you get there and you see it and you get to the lake and you can picture all of this unfolding. You can go to the synagogue where Jesus was, where he cast out demons. You can see what is believed to be Peter's house that he lived in. And then you can go down to the sea and you can imagine Jesus getting into a boat. You can go over to Bethsaida and you can see the first century boat that they discovered years ago that was buried in the bottom of the Sea of Galilee, encased in all of this sort of crustacean or whatever you would call it. Oh, and they had to break that all apart to get this first century fishing boat. It's truly a miraculous find and an amazing thing to see with your own eyes. And so here we read in verse 2 that great crowds gathered around him while he's out there in Capernaum. He gets into the boat, he sits down, and the whole crowd is standing on the beach, and he tells them many things in parables. Now why is he doing this? Why is he talking in parables? Well, a parable really, in some ways, if you could put it this way, is it's like a story or it's like an example. It kind of has a hidden meaning to it. They're fun to try to figure out. And what Jesus does for us in some of the parables, he tells us the parable and then he actually interprets it for us. And then this one, he does that very thing. He tells us the parable and then he interprets it for us as well. But why is he teaching in this way? We get to verse 11 through 17. We're going to jump there in chapter 13, and I want you to see why Jesus is teaching the parables. Because the disciples ask them in verse 10, why do you speak to them, that is, to the crowds that are gathered around, why do you speak to them in parables? Verse 11, he answered them, to you, he's talking to his 12 disciples now, isn't he? To you, 12 disciples, it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them, that is likely to the crowd, likely to the Christ rejecting religious leaders of the day, likely to maybe even the family members that had tried to apprehend him and think that he was mad, to them it has not been given. For to the one who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because seeing, they do not see. Notice again, he's not talking about his disciples' inability to see, but they. They do not see, and hearing, they do not hear, nor do they understand. Indeed, in their case, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled. And he quotes from Isaiah, And before I read this next section, I just want you to note, if you were to go back to Isaiah chapter 6, when God called Isaiah to go and to preach the message of repentance to Israel, he told Isaiah up front, listen, you're going to have a wonderful ministry. It's going to be so fruitless. And that's really what it was. You're going to go and you're going to preach this message, but they're going to hear it, but they're not going to really hear it. They're not going to understand it. They're not going to be able to perceive what you're saying. And so, right here in this passage, we have that Isaiah text quoted. And we're told, indeed, in their case, that indeed in the case of those who are rejecting Jesus, the prophecy of Isaiah is fulfilled. It says, you will indeed hear, but never understand, and you will indeed see, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear. For this people's heart has grown dull, and with their ears they can barely hear, and their eyes they have closed, lest they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. And again, notice the contrast in verse 16. But blessed are your eyes. He's talking to the 12, isn't he? Blessed are your eyes, for they see. Your ears, for they hear. For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people long to see what you see and did not see it, and to hear what you hear and did not hear it. In other words, all of those individuals, all those people, they're not hearing it. They're not understanding it. They're not perceiving it. Their hearts have grown dull. Their ears, they can barely hear. Their eyes are closed. They are living the fulfillment of Isaiah. Isaiah had that ministry. He went out there and they just couldn't get it. You see, it's here to the Christ-rejecting Jewish leaders who are trying to figure out how to destroy Jesus and who claim that Jesus is possessed by Beelzebul, the prince of demons, and saying that he's casting out demons by that prince of demons. It's to them that Jesus speaks in parables as a way of obscuring the truth from them. Because he knows that they will never believe. For they're not chosen by God. Their hearts are hardened. They have been hearing Jesus teach, yet they really don't have the ears to understand. And it's with all of that background that we come to the parable. We come to the parable. The parable of the soils. A parable which explains why some reject the gospel and others do not. So let's read the parable, and then we're going to read the interpretation of the parable. Verses 3 through 9, Jesus gives the parable. Here it is. He says, and he told them many things in parable. Remember, he's addressing the whole crowd as he's sitting in the boat. And he says this, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seed fell along the path, and the birds came and devoured them. Other seed fell along rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched. And since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seed fell on good soil and produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. So Jesus, again, notice as you go through this passage, there's constantly this reference to hearing and not hearing. Understanding, but not really understanding. Seeing, but not really being able to see. And so Jesus introduces this parable to them. And it's this parable that causes them to say, why do you speak to them this way? Why do you speak to them this way? And we just read that passage in the explanation of Jesus why. And then in verses 18 through 23, Jesus gives his disciples the interpretation. Hear then, he says, the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is what was sown along the path. As for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. And when tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. As for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, But the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. As for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. This is the parable of Jesus that he not only teaches but then interprets for us, the parable that we refer to often as the parable of the soils or the parable of the sower. And in teaching this parable, Jesus has three things that he brings out, doesn't he? He talks about the sower, he talks about the seed, and he talks about the soils. And we're going to look at each of those as we kind of break down this parable. First of all, to identify who the seed is, I want you to see that the sower of the seed here is actually Jesus. In the immediate context, the sower of the seed is Jesus. He is casting himself in this parable as a farmer who would go out and he would sow his seed. Back in the old days, they didn't have the big John Deere tractors that they would, you know, haul around that were like $250,000 or whatever. There would be a farmer who would go out and he would have a pouch beside him and he would reach in and he would grab seed out and he would cast the seed. He would just cast it out onto the field. This is Jesus picturing himself as a farmer to his disciples. Remember, everything up to this point has been Jesus teaching and preaching to the people to repent and to believe in the good news and all of the varied responses that people are having to Jesus. He is the sower of this good seed. But it's not just about Jesus, as we'll see. You see, it starts with Jesus, but we know that Jesus called his disciples also to be the ones that would sow. We too are to be the farmer. We're also to sort of put our hands in the satchel or whatever and bring out the seed and to scatter the seed. But again, at this point, what is the seed then? Well, secondly, the seed is the word of God. As the parable gets interpreted, you'll see this. The sower is Jesus, and the seed is the word of God. In Matthew 13:19, for example, we read these words, "When anyone hears the word of the kingdom." So the sower who goes out and he's sowing the seed is really a way of referring to the word or the message of the kingdom that Jesus proclaimed. In Mark 4:14, it simply states that the sower sows the word. Luke tells us in his account, the seed is the word of God. You see, any time that somebody sows the word or sows the seed, they are in the place, in the sense of Jesus here in this text, who is out there and spreading. It could be a preacher on a Sunday morning. It could be somebody at a coffee shop who's sowing the seed. It could be somebody sitting across from another coworker somewhere. It could be at a gas station. Wherever it is, we are to understand ourselves to be like Jesus, the ones who sow the seed, the word of God. But really in particular, again, in its immediate context, Jesus here is identifying himself as the one who sows that word. Because he's the one up to this point who's preaching the word of the kingdom. Again, Mark chapter 1, verse 14 and 15, you remember the passage, it says, "After John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God, and saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand, repent and believe in the gospel." He is the sower. But he invites us to follow him and become sowers as well. I want you to see kind of a little bit of, I'm not sure how well you can see this chart in terms of it's up there or not. There it is. So on this chart, you're going to see this a little bit just to kind of break it down, because I find for me personally it's helpful to put the parable right next to the interpretation so that you can actually see it. Instead of just trying to find it in the text. I want you to notice this is about the parable of the sower and the soils. You have the parable of the soils, the actual parable that's told. On the one side, then you have the interpretation that Jesus gives. And so you see that the sower, in terms of the parable of soils, is just referred to as a sower. We would call that person the farmer. But in the interpretation, it becomes Jesus is the sower, and so are we. With regards to the seed, in verse 3 and following, every time he talks about the sowing of the seed in the parable, the interpretation of that, it's clearly talking about the word of God being communicated, spread. So that's the first thing. So the sower is Jesus and the seed is the word of God. But the third thing in this interpretation I want you to see is that we understand the soils to be human hearts. The soils are the hearts of individuals, people. The soils here in this parable illustrate how different people respond to the gospel when it is preached. And when I say preached, I don't just mean on a Sunday morning from the pulpit. I mean anytime the gospel is communicated to an individual. We are proclaiming, we are telling, we are testifying, we are talking about Jesus. And when we speak to another person, we are speaking as if we're speaking to soil, hearts, human hearts. You know, I worked for a farmer. Here I am, a city guy from Vancouver, Canada, grew up there, never encountered a farm in my life. I moved to Saskatchewan, Canada, I go to Bible college there, I graduate from Bible college, fell in love in Bible college with my wife, with Trina, and she's from Herbert, Saskatchewan, Canada, tiny little town, farming community, and I want to stick around, of course, and then we end up getting married, and then we stay in this little town called Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan, Canada, and I'm looking for a job. And I knew I graduated from Bible college, but I'm okay, what's next? Like, I know I was going to go in the ministry, but like, what's immediate next? And I was talking to a guy at church, and I said, yeah, I'm looking for a job. And he goes, I'm looking for a farmhand. And I said, I know nothing about the farm. He thought about it, and he goes, actually, that could be really good. How do you figure? He said, well, because... trust me, I've had my share of farmhands who I've hired who think they know what they're doing. They want to tell me how to run my farm. And I'm like, listen, you ain't going to get none of that from me. I don't have a clue of what I'm doing. I'll tell you, what a learning curve. I remember having to get out there, and he would be cultivating all of the ground with his big tractors. And then I remember when it came time to... That's all, folks. I remember... I remember the time when it was harvest. We finally got to harvest, right? And he would have his combine out there, and I would have to drive the truck beside the combine, and he'd bring the auger out, and it would fill up that truck, and I'm driving like, oh man, I hope I don't ram this thing. And anyway, you start to get the hand of it, and then you drive. I drove back onto the farm field. Like, that's where I was supposed to take this load of grain, and then I was supposed to, like, back up the truck, right, and it's all the grain pours out into another auger, and that thing is huge. It's going up way up to the top of this grain bin, but that's fine. It's hard to do at first when you're first learning to do that, because like backing something up, and anyway, it's a whole deal, and the auger's inside, like the top of, if you've ever been around a farm, it's inside the top of the grain bin. And so, you know, once you do this, you get the machinery going, and it's carrying up all the grain, it's dropping it into the bin. Well, that was great until the bin gets full, and then you've got to, like, okay, I got to move it to another grain bin. What am I moving? Well, I got to hook up the tractor now, and I got to move that auger over to another grain bin. Man, trying to drive that, if you've ever backed up a boat, it's kind of like that, but worse, because it's a lot bigger. You know, you drive that way, but it goes that way or whatever, and you're like, so, and you're looking at the top of this grain bin, and you're trying to figure out how do I get, it's like the hole this big, and I'm so far away from it. How do I get this thing into that little thing there, this big auger? Okay, so finally, I get backed up, drop it down, I'm like, I got it. I start dumping the grain in. It's not in. It's on the other side of it. It looked like it was in. And grain is just going, just dumping down the whole side. And I'm panicking, right? Finally, I shut the thing off. I didn't lose too much grain. And then I called Daryl and thought, Daryl, I kind of messed up a little here. Anyway, he was very gracious to me. But, you know, he probably recalled the words at the beginning. Well, maybe it's a good idea that you don't know anything about the farm. I remember one time at night, too, we were still doing harvest. It was late at night. And I mean, I was freaked out. Put me in a city where the lights are. But you get out there in the field somewhere by a granary all alone. You know, I'm by the grain truck, and it's like there's animals and noises. And all of a sudden, I'm looking at this metal grain bin, and all I see was this bright green glow on the grain bin. And I turn around, and there's this comet streaking through the sky. Freaked me out, really, to be honest with you. Through, and then it just kind of blew into flames, and I jump back into the truck, and I'm like, Daryl, did you see that? Anyway, there was all kinds of experience. I could go on and on about it, about my time in farming. But one thing I know about farming, if that soil ain't cultivated, nothing is going to happen. Nothing is going to happen, right? And so when we think about the soils, that's what we're talking about. It's a great illustration that Jesus gives to say, you know, he's the sower. You and I, we're the sowers of the seed, the good word of God. We spread the message of the kingdom, the message of the gospel, the truth, and it lands on human hearts that are like soil. But as it lands, what Jesus tells us is that there's, if I can put it this way, bad soil and there's good soil. Meaning bad in the sense that the soil isn't receptive to the seed and the good soil that is. And so I want to walk you through the types of soil that Jesus outlines here for us. Let's first look at the three types of bad soil that he has in this passage. Soil number one, we call it the hard heart. The hard heart. Again, notice in the chart that I provided for you as you break down the parable and then the interpretation beside it of this first type of bad soil. In verse 4, we read, Jesus said, some seed fell along the path and the birds came and devoured them. And then when Jesus interprets this in verse 19, it says, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom, you see it again, the seed is interpreted by Jesus as the word or the message of the kingdom and does not understand it. The evil one then comes and snatches away what's been sown in his heart. You see, the soil is the heart, isn't it? This, Jesus says, is what was sown along the path. Now, to understand this particular soil, this first soil, the hard heart, we call it the hard heart because of the nature of the soil. The soil here is sown along the path. And back in that day when they would sow the seed, there would be pathways along so that the farmer could walk along the path and then he would throw the soil. He wouldn't walk all over sort of the cultivated ground. But as he was throwing the seed, inevitably that seed would land on the hard path and nothing, absolutely nothing was going to happen with that seed. It would just land on the hard path. And it represented the heart of this individual who's just hardened. And they don't understand it. In particular, Jesus saying they don't understand the word about the kingdom. They don't understand the good news, the gospel. And it's not here that Jesus is saying that they're dumb, that they intellectually can't grasp or comprehend the words that are spoken. It's not that it's unintelligible. But you see, there's a difference that Jesus is saying between understanding and really understanding. Right, between hearing and really being able to hear. It's not an intellectual issue. You see, if it was simply an intellectual issue, this is what we sometimes do as Christians. We think, well, if I could just scale the intellectual issues, then people would immediately come to Christ. Believe me, I've studied apologetics for years. I've reasoned and debated and all kinds of different people with different religious groups. If it was that simple, I would have had seen so many people come to know Jesus. But it's not just about the intellect. It isn't. As we read through this passage, Luke tells it this way. He said, the ones along the path are those who have heard. Then the devil comes and takes away the word from their hearts so that they may not believe and be saved. Friends, you and I, just like Jesus, when he sowed the word, when he spread the word of the kingdom, there was a counter kingdom that was going on right alongside everything that Jesus did. There were those who were opposed to him and opposed to his message, and the one who was standing behind that opposition was the devil himself. A counterfeit kingdom with a counterfeit message, a counterfeit gospel, a counterfeit spirit. I see it all the time emerge in the various religious groups around that end up claiming to be Christian that have no roots and anchoring in anything in the history of the Christian church. But they're Johnny-come-latelys that have risen on the scene and they claim to have the truth. You see, but that's the enemy's work. The enemy's always going to do this. And when that seed lands on hard soil, the hardened heart rejects it and the enemy takes it away. In Jesus' description of the soil, he states that Satan is like that bird on that hard soil. And I can't help but wonder that maybe Jesus right here is sort of taking a direct shot at the religious leaders. In the context in chapter 12, they have been after him and they have accused him of actually doing his miracles by the work of Satan. They said, oh yeah, we don't deny his power, but it's a demonic power. And they rejected him all the way through, as we're going to see this Friday, Good Friday, all the way to the cross, they rejected him. The hardening of their heart. That's the first soil. The second soil that's bad is the shallow heart. Notice in the parable, in terms of what actually Jesus states by way of parable, he refers to the other seed that fell on rocky ground, where it did not have much soil. Immediately it springs up, but when the sun rose, they were scorched, they had no root, they withered away. And then when he interprets this, he says, as for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who, again, notice it, hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet he has no root in himself, but endures for a while. When tribulation or persecution arises on account of the word, immediately he falls away. Luke tells us that the ones that are on the rock are those who, when they hear the word, they receive it with joy. They have no root. They believe for a while. And at a time of testing, they fall away. Like it looks good at the beginning, doesn't it? It looks good at the beginning. But Jesus said, but there's no root. You see, this is the kind of thing when the sower goes out to sow, it's not falling on the hard path. It's falling on a place where there's sort of a shallow surface of dirt, right? And in particular, in that particular area in Israel too, underneath the dirt in certain areas, there's just a certain stone, a certain rock that's under there that's shallow. The roots are not going to go down. It'll immediately pop up, but it can't do anything else. That's what's pictured here. That's what's the image that Jesus is giving. They immediately hear it. They immediately receive it. It seems to have life, but it really doesn't. It immediately falls away when difficulties come. Warren Wiersbe refers to this particular type of soil as the emotional hearer who joyfully accepts God's word but doesn't really understand the price that must be paid to become a genuine Christian. They may have great enthusiasm for several days, maybe even weeks, but when persecution comes, when difficulty comes because of the word, that enthusiasm wanes and the joy disappears. And it's easy for a fallen human nature to counterfeit religious feelings and give a professed Christian a feeling of false confidence. Now, part of this is the problem in part of some modern day kind of approaches to communicating to the gospel. We have to be honest about that. It was never a problem for Jesus and his disciples. He always served it up exactly the way that it was supposed to be. But sometimes this sort of, I guess you could say, maybe so-called Christian is the product of weak preaching. It's the product of a preaching of a gospel that's really not a gospel, if I can put it that way. It's the result of a message that's lacking in a call to repent, that is to turn from sin. It makes no mention of the cost of discipleship. It's the result of preaching this false message that people come to Jesus for a better life, right? A better life, here and now, more fulfilling life, here and now. He will give you what you want, here and now. But it's a life that knows nothing of the call that Jesus gave to deny oneself. It tends to be about shallow, if I can put it that way, professions. I made a profession. I said yes to this, but what were you saying yes to? You see, of these individuals, verse 17 tells us they have no root. They endure for a while. Then when tribulation or persecution arises, immediately they fall away. We do not do service to people if we do not tell them that there's a cost in following Jesus, right? We have to be upfront with people to say, listen, like, as we will see this coming Sunday in the pearl of great price, when you understand the treasure that's hidden in the field, you're willing to give up everything to follow Jesus. You give up all this world's goods for the sake of the true treasure. You see, what's needed today is a counter to the easy believism that's preached by man is solid gospel preaching like Jesus preached, preaching about sin and the need of repentance like Jesus preached, preaching about the cost of following him. Jesus taught the crowds about that cost. Remember this passage that I opened up with in John 6:6:6. The crowds that were there, once they heard Jesus, these difficult sort of teachings of Jesus, what did they do? Many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. We're like, whoa, wait a second. I didn't sign up for that. You don't want to know what you're signing up for. You're a follower of Jesus Christ, right? I don't know, but I think the word following still means to follow, right? Like, it's so if you're going to follow, you follow. So they started out strong, but they turned away. And I want you to notice that in all three of these types of soils, right, there's three types of soil that they constantly hear, and that takes us to the third type of soil, and that is the crowded heart. Notice again the parable that's given in verse 7, other seed falls among the thorns and grows up and it chokes them. And then in the interpretation, Jesus said, as for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word, but the cares of the world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and it proves unfruitful. This hearer has, you could say, too many different kinds of seeds growing in the soil. Right? It's not the word of God. It's worldly cares, desire for riches, a lust for things. And the good seed of the word has no room in which to grow. It's getting choked out by all the others. The only thing that I can think of, because I didn't have enough time in farming personally, but I remember when we lived in Utah, I don't know if it's here, but it probably is, I can't stand it. Maybe some of you love it. It's called morning glory. This thing that would grow in our yard, garden, and it would like wrap itself like just around every single thing. And there's nothing glorious about it. I don't know who named it morning glory, but there's nothing glorious about it. And you'd have to get that stuff out, and it was just like, it would choke absolutely everything, right? And that's what it reminds me of, is sort of like, there is this sort of, all of these things that are crowding out the heart. It's the crowded heart, or maybe you could call it the worldly heart. It's that person who's so preoccupied with worldly matters. It's someone who lives for the world, the things of the world. They have one foot in the world, and they have one foot in the church. It's a double-minded person, as Scripture says. They're uncommitted. They're preoccupied with the worldly things, the world's pleasures, money, career, fame, fortune, the lusts of the flesh, and on. They might look like they're a Christian, but they're not. But they're not. When I became a Christian, probably about 5 weeks after I became a Christian, I had my two cousins who both appeared to become Christians. My cousins' names are Lee and Jay. I grew up with these guys as cousins. We hung out all the time. One day they called me up and they said, we'd like to come to church. And I said, fantastic, come to church. So brought them to church. I had no idea that I could actually sow the seed of the gospel in their own lives. I just was like, well, you got to talk to the youth pastor. He can do that for you because, you know, they know what to do. So I brought them to church and introduced them to Shane, our youth pastor, after that. And Shane ended up leading them to Christ. And my cousin Jay took off like a rocket. I mean, I was like, wow. I had heard that he had read like the whole Bible in a month. I was like, seriously? My cousin Lee didn't take off like a rocket, and I was worried. I was like, what's going on with my cousin Lee? Well, within a month or so, my cousin Jay had just completely rejected it all, just totally turned away. But my cousin Lee began to grab hold, and he began to grow, and he began to grow immensely. I went off to Bible college, and then he comes to Bible college in my second year. We're roommates all through our college years. He's a pastor today. He's a pastor, right? Now, that's not the path of everybody, becoming pastors. Good thing, right? We don't want too many of us. But it was such a contrast to me. It really reminded me of how my cousin Jay had really, he had that crowded heart, that he had the one foot over here and the other foot over here, and all that worldly stuff really overtook him, and in the end has led him astray, and he's never returned. Now I'd say to you about, frankly, if I can say this, about any of these soils that we would say are bad soil, don't ever give up on them. Don't ever give up on them. You know, just because somebody today or tomorrow doesn't really give their life to Jesus, they have their heart's hearted, or they've got this crowded heart, or they got the shallow heart. Like, we don't know what God's going to do in their life in the next week, month, years. We don't know. That's not our business to know that, actually. What our business is, that you'll hear, is to be like the sower. That's our job. God's job is the other part. And so notice that all three of these soils, though, are humans' hearts. They hear the word preached, but according to Jesus, they hear, but they don't truly hear. They have ears, but they don't hear. And now what is it they're not hearing? They're not hearing what I describe, and I didn't come up with this. Theologians long before me did, what's called the internal call of God in the gospel. You see, friends, there's two different calls that come in people's lives. Every single person that exists in this world needs to hear the external call of the gospel preached. They need to hear about Jesus. That's our responsibility. We got to tell the whole world about Jesus. That's what we're called to do. But you and I have nothing to do with the internal call of God that happens inside a person's life. That's God who does that. And the beauty of the gospel is when the gospel goes out in power, they hear it because that's the external call, but they need to hear the internal call of the Spirit. And when those two line up, that person will come to know Jesus when the time is right. And that brings us now to the last soil, and that is the good soil. In this parable, Jesus identifies the good soil, and we call it the fruitful heart. Notice in verse 8, some seed fell on good soil. All of the soil up to this point wasn't good soil. And that soil produced grain, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. And then Jesus, in verse 23, interprets it. And he says, as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it. He indeed bears fruit and yields, in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. You see, these right here, this soil, this is Jesus saying, these are the people who are true believers. They heard the external call. And they didn't give themselves the internal call. You don't give yourself the internal call. God by his Spirit gives you the internal call. But you hear the external call, the internal call aligns with it, and you come to know Jesus. For me, that was on July 25th, 1987. When I walked down the aisle of a church and I knelt at the stairs and God got a hold of my heart. That's when it happened for me. But it has to be a point in time in which that happens. Notice of these believers, Jesus said, there's three things in verse 23. First, they hear the word. They hear it. But notice now, and secondly, they understand it. This is different than the first one. Remember the first one along the path? They heard it, but they did not understand it. You see, again, we're not talking about simply an acknowledgement or an intellectual grasp of a set of propositions here. We're talking about a spiritual understanding. And then third, they bear fruit. And I want to suggest to you this morning that this is not a parable for you and I to say, okay, if I want to be a true believer, I better get out there and start bearing fruit. That misses the point of this parable. You see, because if you really have heard the gospel, the external call of God, and when the time that you heard the gospel is lined up with the internal goal and internal call of God through his Spirit, you become a Christian, the issue of bearing fruit is settled, friends. You don't have to conjure up bearing fruit. You don't have to work for it. But notice what it says in this passage. When that happens, he indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another case 60, and in another 30. There's varying fruit among the people of God. We don't all bear the same fruit. We don't all bear the fruit in the exact same way. We're not held to account by God for, you know, Billy Graham's level of fruitfulness in his life and ministry, held to his standard. God had called him to do what he's doing, and he bore a lot of fruit. But friends, if we have no fruit, we have no root. Let's put it that way, right? If we have no fruit, we have no root. You see, the reality is this. It's really simple. If you and I are born again, that's what we call spiritual regeneration. That's where God changes you on the inside. You become a Christian. It's not simply and merely an intellectual, mental decision that you and I make. It's the power of the Spirit of God working inside you when you hear the gospel and you say, I need Jesus. I need Jesus. And when you give your life to Jesus, you are regenerated. You're born again. New life has begun. You're a new creation in Christ, he says in 2 Corinthians 5:17. And the automatic response and result of that is fruit will start to be evident. So if anybody reads this parable and says, oh, I don't have fruit, then maybe you look inside. But Jesus' point here is to really remind us this is his work, and he brings people to himself. One of my favorite stories from church history is with George Whitefield. George Whitefield was a great revivalist of the First Great Awakening. It's not like he woke up one day and said, God, I aspire to be a great revivalist. Usually people that do that, you're kind of like, okay, whatever, bro. He just wanted to be used by God, and he was. And he came to America in the early colonies, early days, and 1700s, and he went up and down to the colonies preaching the gospel, and incredible revivals took place. There's this one account of George Whitefield, how he was one of those guys that back in the day, you just didn't do this kind of stuff, right? Like, I mean, churches and things get stupid sometimes, if I can put it that way, right? Like, here's the stupid piece. When a church says, well, you can only preach inside a church. You know, that's what it was back in the day, right? You're going to, okay, that's stupid, right? But back in the day, that was like, you wouldn't do that. Anybody that went out of that mold was like, they were like on the outs with the church. Whitefield was one of those guys. Whitefield, he was an open-air preacher, so he would go, and he's like, why? Well, people aren't coming to church. We got to go to them. So he did. He went to them, and he preached up and down in the colonies, and he gets to the coal miners, and he stands upon a hill, and he starts preaching, and he apparently had this incredibly powerful voice where he could project his voice. Coal miners started coming out of the mines, and he preached the gospel to them, and the account of which, when you read it, it says, as he preached the gospel to them, there were rivers of white that would appear on their faces as they heard the gospel. Beautiful picture, right? As the dark coal would reveal that these guys are crying because they realize that they need Jesus. It was an exceptional time in church history. Did they respond because Whitefield had the necessary skills to preach in such a way that the hearers felt compelled to believe? Oh, if I could just be like Whitefield, more would come. No. You see, that puts far too much on man, doesn't it? It was not about the power of Whitefield. It was about the power of God at work in and through a yielded servant named Whitefield. As he faithfully gave the external call of the gospel, and he knew his responsibility was simple and singular. Preach the gospel so that all can hear. But he knew that only those who hear the inward call of God by the Holy Spirit will have the capability to truly hear because God has called them. You see, Paul made this clear, didn't he, in 1 Corinthians chapter 2? He said these words, I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I was with you in weakness and in fear and much trembling. My speech and my message were not in plausible words of wisdom, but in demonstration of the Spirit and of power. Friend, we have a power problem today is what we have. That's what we have. We need the power of God, right? So how does this apply to us? Let me summarize it in this as we close. To answer this question, Mark chapter 4, and also in Matthew chapter 13, we're told of another parable, and it's simply stated this way. The kingdom of God is if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He knows not how. The earth produces by itself first the blade, then the ear, then the full grain in the ear. But when the grain is ripe, at once he puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. The one who is the sower of the seed here in this, again, is the one who preaches the word, who spreads the good news of the gospel. He or she scatters it on the ground, as we've seen, and it lands on four types of soils or hearts. And then in verse 27, notice what it says. We're told he sleeps, and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows, he knows not how. He knows not how. It's not his work. It's not her work. He has no idea how it's happening. His responsibility is to simply preach the word, to spread the gospel to everyone, and he or she can go to sleep at night knowing that they have done what they were supposed to do. So friends, if you consider yourself a genuine follower of Jesus, you, like me, we're all sowers of the word of God. And we don't all sow it the same, but the message is the same. And as those who sow the seed, we're not responsible for determining who is elect or chosen, as much as those conversations are fun to have in terms of what the Word of God teaches, but it's not our responsibility to determine that. That's God's. It's his business. Nor are we responsible for who responds. We don't cause growth. We simply sow the seed, preach the word, spread the gospel, and how it grows, we know not. So here's our role: to faithfully spread the gospel, to clearly proclaim the gospel. We're to preach Christ and him crucified. Our speech and our message should be simple and straightforward, not in plausible words of wisdom, but in a demonstration of spirit and power. And our role is to unashamedly preach the gospel. That's what we're called to do. And it's important to remember that Jesus even taught us that not everyone's going to hear and believe as much as we want them to. There will be people who will reject you because they reject the message. Just as the vast majority in Jesus' day really rejected him and rejected his message. But friends, there is a harvest that needs to come in. We have people that are outside these walls that are ripe for harvest. They just need somebody to talk to them about Jesus. We're to go into that harvest. We're to enter the fields because they're ripe. And we're to invite people to Jesus. And I want to encourage you to do that, especially with Easter coming. It's always a good time to invite people in to come to church. Bring them on Easter Sunday. If they can't come on Sunday, begin a conversation. Ask God, who does God have in your world around you that you can just take whatever time is necessary to just love them as Jesus would love them, and hope that you can plant a seed or seeds in their lives that God may bring to fruit. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. Thank you, Lord, that there's great freedom, Lord, that we have in knowing that you're the one who's in control, not us, that you're the sovereign one, Lord, that we don't have to try to, coerce or manipulate or manufacture or guilt or whatever other forms people use, but we just have to speak the truth. And help us to do that in ways that are full of grace and truth and love, and that you'd use each of us as we sow the word in different ways, and as we communicate that one message in varied ways. We leave it in your hands to use us for your glory, in Jesus' name. Amen.